I was watching, I never felt that Springbok was going to lose the first test. Like, back in the day, we used to bully people and then bring on more bullies. Is this sustainable? Are we going to have a bomb squad in 4 years' time?
Oh, we're changing it to BTR consultant now.
Okay, like, soon. Okay. Okay.
I'll just talk to HR.
Ruckers, it's seatbelt time, okay? My foot is sleeping on the gas pedal, okay? You know who I am. It's Juwan de Jong in the house. It's next to me. It's the one and the only. Here we go.
Partner, Ruckers. Hey, here we go. My tanner is getrekt. It is tough. The Fox lost. But Rudy Pates is back. I'm alive. The sun is not out in Cape Town, but somewhere in Africa, the sun is out and the Bokkies will be back. But guys, let's go for another episode, partner. I'm excited.
Full felt episode, eh? It's so dumb, eh? Why must we go there, man? Huh?
No, we gotta take it on the chin. The Bokkies we lost by 1 point. Yes, we were on the other side of the 1 point.
But okay, but that's life. It's life.
But partner, behind the ruck is a direct in the life, okay? Or stick eight, or keep on cracking on,
take it on the chin.
Yes. We were a bit loud last week because we thought we were on top of the world again.
Yes,
such is life, boys, okay? I let the seatbelt island put the seatbelt on us.
On us, incoming tour, it is what it is. But yeah, what experience that was. Up in Durban, the two of us, a fan frenzy. What do you call it again?
Fan frenzy.
Okay. French fries.
But it was excellent. Ruckers, we had fun there in Durban. I must say, the vibe was actually better than at Loftus. Durban people know how to party.
Did you
They
say
know
that?
How to get behind the team. No, Durban was excellent.
I've never heard you say better than Loftus.
No, it was. Oh, is it? Maybe okay. three times yeah, better.
I agree. The atmosphere was incredible. Obviously, because the stadium is pretty much packed onto the field and you can feel the vibe, you can feel the energy. I mean, the impis was running around and stuff like that. We had beasts. On the thing.
Beastie was there for Donkey Kong. A man-made Donkey Kong.
Yeah, the Durban vibes, eh? KwaZulu-Natal had something special because Shasha Ngoma Zulu did this thing. Because there was a Zulu on the stoop for 15, okay?
No. And Ruckers, it was 28 degrees in Durban. Us from Cape Town, that we lived this side. It was excellent. So, brilliant weekend. Exciting weekend coming up. We're going to get stuck into all of that soon.
What's happening. I can't wait for this weekend.
Let's go.
We're going to be in Bloemfontein.
Let's take on this episode,
let's get into this episode. And while we're getting into this episode, okay, guys, Behind the Ruck is supported by SuperSportBET, the one, the only SuperSportBET. And also, must we say it again, we're dressed by the best in the business, old school. We're taking it way back to school. Old school apparel sponsor.
Perfect. And Ruckers, as you guys can see around us, we're not thirsty to drink. But we are today visiting Bayer's Kloof, close to my partner's house and our guest today on the episode. Mm-hmm. So that is why we're at Bayer's Kloof. We visit them.
Yes.
We asked them, hey, can we get a place, please?
Yes.
They said yes. So also I'm drunk to Ruckers. Okay, Ruckers?
Bayer's must be careful. Thirsty?
Listen. partner, today, I want to give the line out, Ruckers. The menu for today is quite simple, okay? Mm-hmm. We are going to have a friend of the show, a consultant, the mastermind, the master class.
OG Powie.
Exactly, the original gangster Power Ranger. We have Gio Aplon today back in
again.
The house. Again.
Back to back.
Oh,
four times. He's been here. He loves the BTR.
Exactly.
But it's awesome, eh? Because obviously when we cut it to the bone, okay? It's been pretty much a great incoming series. The island world number one, okay, versus world number two, okay? We need to cut this thing to the bone.
Okay.
See what's happening.
Yes, while my partner's cutting it to the bone, okay, we're going to have analyst Gio Aplon and so we're going to discuss the rugby, the All Blacks versus England, guys. We're going to talk about the fixtures. There's not a lot of big games happening this week. We're obviously going to get stuck into Portugal versus the Springboks and then we're going to have our SuperSport bet pick. Okay, guys, one pick or two pick or three picks.
But
wait.
We'll pick it up.
There we go. Put on your seatbelts and sit back
strap
and let's
up,
go
strap
and
up, strap
put
up,
on your favorite show. On the line, okay?
Hey, here we go. Number one, my
happy
podcast.
Days, man.
Hey, you ready?
I'm ready, can't wait.
I'm not
let's
sure. You
going.
Ready?
I'm ready, man.
Let's get to hosting.
Let's say.
Okay. Yep, up next, Gio Aplon.
Let's
here we go.
Go.
Ruckers, it's the darling of Austin in here. Hey, he's a friend of the show.
He's back.
He's back. I don't know. It's the consultant of BTR. I don't know.
Do we still even say hello, partner?
I don't know. I don't know. He's going to ask a salary soon, okay? Live and direct is the main man, Gio Aplon.
I like that salary part.
I knew it.
Yes, things,
hey?
Good. Good to be back, man. Yes. Absolutely good to be back. Yes. Exciting weekend. Mm. Lots of ups and downs, but yeah.
Yeah, it's been proper a while, man.
Rugby and full
proper,
flow.
Proper.
Mm, were you at the games, eh? Loftus, you kind of, you know, and Derby, no?
Nee, ik moest je gras gesneden.
Okay.
But
is
I ga to Bloem. Bloem?
Yeah. The pens on, is that in the Bloem box?
He wants to be in the Bloem box.
Hey, yeah, no. But boykies, let's start immediately.
Let's get deep. Let's get
24-25. Let's start in Durban, yes. First of all.
Springboks versus Ireland. Yeah. Okay, the king of the world versus the king of Europe.
Yes, huh? And obviously, unfortunate Ruckers. We didn't start. Obviously, lost the game. 1 point is difficult being now that we're on the other side of that coin in the World Cup. We had 3 1-pointers that we won. First of all, Gio, what were your thoughts on the game?
Unbelievable test, mates. Loftus was good, but I think Durban was incredible. The intensity, the fight back, the drama at the end, there was everything in it. I think probably one of the best test matches we've seen in the last year, apart from after the World Cup.
Yes.
Incredible.
It's incredible, yeah. And that's from all departments. That's from scrums. It's attack, it's defense. So looking at the Springboks now, it's a different look when it comes to the Springboks. The differences that you've seen, especially Loftus and even Durban, is one when it comes to Tony Brown and Flannery, okay, and defense attack. Yes. What have you seen, the differences, what we see from the box now than the previous couple of seasons?
Yeah, I think there's a bit more of a shift in the focus to a bit of attacking with width. And that's what Willy brings. But also to see Sia taking up the ball from the set piece, that's something different. And then also Peter Steff and Sia being in the wider channels, just to give the box a little bit of an edge, and that's what Tony Brown brings. Yes, we shied away a bit from our mauling. We shied a bit away from, I won't say from our scrubbing, but from our general bullying tactics. Mm. But again, it's 2024, the World Cup is in 2027. If we don't try stuff now, we won't know in 2 years. Yeah. I mean, 2 years' time, we're going to maybe get to a point where people stop our moors and we are less physical, and people are going to say, oh, what did you do the last 3 years? So I think it's a good time to start. People take into account it's only been 2 tests. Mm. One test where stuff went reasonably well, and the second test, when Pollard plays, I always said last time, when Pollard plays, Willy needs to play, and Willy was off early, so we couldn't see what we expected to see. But I think it's a second test. I think give it the year, and then after the year, we say, listen, attacking rugby don't work or doesn't work or whatever, but give it a chance.
Yeah, no. And Gio, were you surprised that Ireland beat us? Were you surprised by the result of the game, especially after the first test at Loftus?
No.
Not surprised.
No, Ireland's a good outfit.
Okay.
I think Ireland is a good outfit. I mean, looking at the first game, it could have gone, even though the score was 27-20, it could have gone either way. Yeah. If you look at that moments, the moments of James Lowe, the moments of not scoring that try, the moments of that foot just getting the ball back.
Cheslin's.
And Cheslin's try as well. So, I must say the Springboks was very good this past couple of games, but also saying the Ireland is not a soft in a bad outfit.
No, for sure. And I think if you take it a little bit back in terms of Ireland, like after that performance by the Springboks, because when I was watching, I never felt the Springboks were going to lose the first test. Like they felt like they're always in control. And we expected them to kick on from then in the second test, and that's why no one expected Ireland to come back. But again, I think someone mentioned that Ireland trained once. But the detail,
fresh,
but the detail, if you think that Jamie Osborne, is normally a center, but he played at fullback. He's a center for Leinster, he plays center. Yeah. And then the new guys, Calvin Nash was there, Mac Hansen is normally there, James Lowe was there, Jameson Gibson-Park wasn't there. Yes, Jack Crowley is there, probably their first hits in South Africa. And there was a lot of guys that weren't there, but again, they came back and listened to a couple of other podcast, not the main one.
Okay.
With the friend of the show, we might.
Hey, let's say
other couple of conversations.
Okay. There we go.
And they say that Andy Farrell really is a detailed coach, But in the other end also, he gets out of the players that like what Rashi gets out of the players, he gets that extra 5% out of the players, and that makes them a dangerous outfit. And you could see like they never went away. The same as the Springboks in the World Cup. We never go away. And Ireland has got that little bit of mantra now that they don't go away.
Mm. And partner, let's look at the start of the game. Because obviously Gio just mentioned now we lost Willy. I didn't expect the physicality or the level of physicality that Ireland brought to the game, especially that first 20 minutes. That was impressive, James, wasn't it?
Yeah. And Gio, you spoke about now losing Willy and the Andre Pollard-Willy combination. What's your thinking around that? We've got options at the back as well, like Damien Willems, and we've got Willy as well. And this weekend, we got Shasen Ngoma Zulu. Okay, as an option. But with Mane at 10, with Pollard at 10, and maybe Sia Masuku, you never know. What do you think about leading the team and connecting with the team? What 10 fits with what 15 and vice versa that connects with the team?
I personally believe if you play Pollard, you have to play Willy. Because Pollard can't get the game going as Mane can. I think Mane can run the show on his own. He doesn't need another fullback. He can play with Damien, he can play with Willy, whoever. But Mane can run the show from a attacking point of view. Pollard is more calm. He can sit back in the pocket. He controls the game a bit more. But to expect him to play the attacking game and also take control of that was a bit too much, in my opinion. I think he's still a brilliant rugby player. He showed, again this weekend, 8 out of 8. Unbelievable. But I think we have options. We can play Mane. You can play Siana, you can give him a go. You can play Sia Masuku. You can even bring Damien Willems, who played 10, in this new style of play. And in the next year, we should try that and see who's best fit to play this attacking kind of brand. And you'll always have Pollard back in the pocket. And you'll always have Willy, like a Mone State. And you can bring them just before the World Cup and they can play. But I think it's time to expand now. But I also think Willy and Pollard is a combo. But then any other one of the fly-offs can run the show by themselves.
Yeah.
Interesting, obviously, then we lost Willy. That was the reality. Early. Then we lost Eben with blood. Then Sous went off with blood. That was within the first 8 minutes, Gio, of the game. That was for me the big surprise when they come out of the blocks. They fronted up an island team, fronted up to the box in our hometown. And that for me was quite the impressive part about Ireland's performance this past weekend.
Is it Ireland that showed us what physicality is because they kind of know what we bring with physicality? Or was it just freak accidents and unlucky injuries?
that's a good one. I think just from the start, I think Ireland like you have, there's two sides of the coin. It's your last game. It's the last game of the season. You can say, let's just get through this one. But they really showed up and it meant something for them to win this game.
You
that's firstly. And secondly, that early changes with Eben and Sous going in off the field and on the field had an effect on the 50th minute where we normally send that six guys on. And I think that was the difference in this test, that we couldn't send those six guys on and make a massive difference. And they had to send one, and then Eben came off, and then Erge went back on, and then Salomon came on, and it was a stop start, and then the front rowers went on, and they couldn't really get momentum. So I think the strength of the Springboks are still in the bomb squad. If whether you're going to play expensive rugby, I think the bomb squad is still a massive part of it.
Performance,
and it makes you a bit worried hearing now about some of the injuries, that the bomb squad is still so effective going forward, even if you're going to play expensive. So are we really progressing? If we lose a Marks or someone in the bomb squad again, what effect is this going to have on the outcome of the 80 minutes of the Springboks? We can play for 50 minutes. When the bomb squad comes on, we bring another 30 minutes. But how is that going to affect the whole of our game, where we normally hold on to the last 10 minutes, where we hang in there and we fight and we bully people? What is the effect of the bomb squad going to have going forward if we don't have some of those key players, or we can't send six of them at the same time?
At the same time, yeah. And that makes a big difference, especially when you send six of them at the same time, because pretty much I think those six guys has been training together. So when we do the training sessions within the week, those guys, they train together, they're scrumming together, getting used to each other. Now all of a sudden when it comes to the game, they have to change it up a little bit. So one and two plays with a different three, and two and three plays with a different one, those type of things. But it's very interesting to see. But I must say we've grown a lot when it comes to our bomb squad. We also got the 7-1 split. Not a fan. Like even like this weekend, if we do get injuries early, it makes a difference. And especially when you do, it's only two backs on the bench. If you do get the injury like with Vivelli and then Sasha needs to go on early, then Grant has to play 10 to 5 or whatever minutes. It makes it quite tough when it comes to planning.
And on that partner, I actually want to give Rassi a lot of credit. Even though Sasha went on early, he still brought on Grant at the 45th minute.
So it's a gamble, yeah.
It's a big, but I like that about Rassi, man. He's not scared to risk it because our game at the time needed Grant to be on the field. Because in the first half, we didn't have any impetus into the game. Mm. We were quite lackluster in our attack. Mm. And I thought when Grant came onto the pitch, there was immediately a zipper, like energy. His work to the breakdown, his kicking, his box kicks were far better than Faf's in the first half.
Yeah.
So for me, that's where Rassi, I think Rassi is brilliant at. He's not scared to make the big calls. Mm.
And also credit to Grant. We know him as a fast player. Get there, make snipes, fastest player in the Springbok squad. Mm. But he brought a calmness. He was good at his kicking game. He knew when to relieve the pressure. Got the ball from the kickoff. Kicked it probably 60, 70 meters downfield. And that was incredible on by Grant. The other thing in terms of the bomb squad, which we also still need to figure out, is now we are running people ragged. And then we're going to bring on the bomb squad. Back in the day, we used to bully people and then bring on more bullies. So we still need to find in this year the balance. Is that working by running them around? And then when they tired, bring on the bullies, call it in that terms, or bully them and bully them again. So we still need to find that mix. So in the next 4 years, we're going to see a lot of, and the fans need to be patient because we want to evolve and we want to go to the next generation. Yeah. I think we'll probably have a chat later on about the next generation and what's happening. But we need to see where the game's going. And also, is this sustainable? Are we going to have a bomb squad in 4 years' time after these guys retire? That's the question for Springbok Rugby also. Are we going to have those bully type of forwards? Do we have them now in the URC? Maybe not. Are we going to have them? So should we expand our game to a point where we have a different style or we're moving into a style because we've got incredible backs? We've got dynamic loose forwards. If you think of Cameron Hanekom, who is Ivan Roos, they're dynamic in the wide challenge. Mm. So do you really want to use them as so-called bullies, or do you want to use them in the wide channels to get us momentum and get their athleticism to get the answer?
I was figuring that from my head as well.
To get one-on-ones with them because they're tough, they can move. So is that where we're heading, or that we should take a look at? So when we get there one day, that we prepared for that, because I can tell you now. Sorry, this is a long thing. I can tell you now, the All Blacks are already looking ahead. I mean, if you think one of the attack coaches is with Ireland, Andrew Goodman, Tony Brown is with the Springboks, Joe Smith is
Australia,
Warren Gatland is in Wales. So they're going to take all that IP back. So they already, they may be conceding now, I said, listen, the Springboks got us. But in 2 or 3 years' time, if they bring all that IP back or share that IP, then we're behind again. So we need to think a generation a cycle ahead of where we're going to.
And Gio, you obviously as an old Springbok, an exciting running Springbok, how happy are you to see that we are expanding, we are trying to throw the ball, we are moving to 4-5-man lineouts? Is it exciting for you to see Springbok rugby play that way?
Absolutely. There's not a lot of people do not agree with this. They think we should go back and play traditional Springbok rugby. But I always believe that if you look at the country and if you go to club rugby now, there's no malls. I mean, maybe your big clubs, Durbanville or Hamilton's, but if you go to Austin, if you go to Borland, if you go to SVD, they're running the ball. So if people start seeing that, yes, there's a place for me running the ball, because in the last 3 years, we were so like, if I'm not big enough, if I'm not strong enough, I might not play for the Springboks. But if you think of it now, going into the future, if you start playing the ball and your skills come into place and your mobility comes into play, then it becomes a different story for us. And also thinking of Eben, the first time I've seen him playing the ball, and that excites me. They got a different skill set. Mm. Under pressure, get the ball away. So imagine you've got the bullying effect and you can play wide. No, then we're going to become extremely dangerous.
And just a question for both of you. Okay, what I've picked up, especially from the first game Loftus in the second game Durban, the first game Loftus, we moved the ball around. Mm. Like you said, we had Peter Steff in the wide channels, we had Sieno in the other channels. Mm. But when it came to Durban, for me personally, it feels like we changed it a little bit. I know Rassie's a genius in picking up plans because he's probably checking, okay, cool, Ireland is, what's the first game, knowing you're moving a ball around. Because for me personally, when it comes to that second game, we sometimes did up in the middle, chip kicks over the top with Cheslin chasing, hit a couple of phases, then we go in a cross kick with Andre Pollard. Some of them was a bit too long. Do you feel like, did you see guys the same way in terms of how we changed it a little bit, or do you still feel like we moved it around? Because it felt to me like we went a little bit in attack to kick a bit, then where Loftus was more attack it around him.
Yeah, just also, you must also remember the difference in the games. So the first game we started with the bang. We were on the front foot, we were getting there, we were physical. So it was easier to get the ball. The second game, we were a bit more under pressure. Then losing Vali, losing a link, getting Sasha on, great individually, but he's not accustomed to the system of, he's not comfortable enough yet to get into the line and to be that second receiver and to be that guy to play. So I think at the stage, we were also just thinking, no, I won't say surviving, but let's just get there, let's just do something different. And yeah, it was just a game of two halves, if you can think, basically. Or two tests of two halves. Mm.
And I think the pressure makes you, you revert back to what you know.
Mm.
That is normal as a player. We've always played this kicking, suffocating game. And I think the first 20 minutes, our boys just felt the pressure.
Mm.
And that's the first thing that you revert to.
Exactly.
It's kick, suffocate, absolutely, going to the line out. And I think they must have, obviously, Rassi must have had a lashing at them halftime because immediately after halftime, a change.
Yeah.
They went to a four-man where they see our best up in the middle.
Yes.
So they tried to go from the one side to the other 15 immediately. So it was definitely a plan that they want to play.
Yeah, yes.
But I think it's going to take time. As you said, it's going to take time for them for attacking rugby second nature for us.
Mm. And it felt to me like we're putting pressure on ourselves because we got into the 22, like Quagga kicked it through, got the ball, but at the knock-on. Yeah. Then Fafi with the knock-on over there. Then with the grabber and stuff like that. We're putting pressure on ourselves. But then, are you forcing your plan A, or should we go to a plan B, or are you going to a plan C? And that was kind of like, where are we? But I must say, the second half, it looked a lot better. You know, especially the pressure they put onto them. Doris got a yellow card. We got in behind them. We scored a couple of tries. So that was good to see how we adapted.
And I my thing when I watched the game, Gio, was obviously the 3 points, you're constantly putting scoreboard pressure. But when we had that dominance, when I don't know the right answer. I'm asking you two. When do you decide, yeah, let's take our chances, go to the corner, trying to get 7 points instead of three? Because obviously by going for three constantly, the score will always stay close. We'll never get that 2 points or two scores away from them.
I think for me, it personally depends on the time. So when it's still early in the game, you can take your three, you can take your six, you can take your nine to bolt. Because the thing is, sometimes you feel like, hey, the score is now 13-3, you're 10 points behind, you want to get that seven under your belt. But if you go to the corner, you don't get it, then you're in that spiral, a downward spiral. And I felt to me like the box felt like, hey, things don't go, it's not going for us. Let's get the scoreboard going. That's why we're pretty much in the game. That's why we got ahead to 24, 20, whatever the score was. Yes. And gave our opportunity to pretty much won the game at minute 77, yeah.
Yes. But I also think the Springboks are a bit reluctant to maul against the Irish. I think Rassi mentioned something. But if you go back to the World Cup, we didn't maul against them. The first test, we didn't maul against them again, or in the second test. So there's a reluctance because they believe Ireland has got a funny way of stopping them all. But Ireland also did brilliantly in that regard, and give them credit. They nullified them all. The scrums was 50-50. They got away with the free kick here, and they mixed it up. Our defense was a bit nullified by them playing that inside ball and punching through that, and then immediately making our defense short, because when you go through the middle, that fold can't come around fast enough, and these guys can't get with as when Jesse makes a spot, or that BC gets the ball or makes the spot, and then you can fold easily. So they nullified that. I think physically they came for us, and then high balls, they escorted that guy. So our five pillars that our game was built on, we only could do one, basically the scrumming, and we couldn't physically dominate them because they were up for it. So I think there we also lost a bit of the battle that what we normally do. So imagine, you go back to Pretoria, we still had those kind of things. Yes, the escorting was there. We still had a bit of dominance. We're still on the front foot. But now imagine a team has been, they've won a World Cup on the five pillars. Now suddenly you're under pressure. You still want to play a new game. That's why when the pressure was on, they reverted back to small little things that they kind of know, but not sure, should be played now. Is it plan A? Is it plan B? So I think the pressure Ireland put on us that we normally put on other teams was just to such an extent that I think we were a bit rattled at times. Okay. It didn't look like it, but I think we were a bit rattled to what we normally
looking
know.
At it, there was a lot of cross kicks from Farali to the wide, into that wide channel. Mm. The wingers catching the ball into space. What does that mean that Cheslin and Kretli was a bit tight? Why were they tight?
Because they played the inside ball.
Inside ball and get in behind them. The fold can't get around. Very interesting. And that's credit to actually to Farrell, you know, for planning this. And only, like you guys had said, one session to plan this in one session is incredible.
I wish I had a coach where like that back in my days.
Huh? One session a week.
One session a week. That sounds like brilliant.
With that detail.
Huh? Yes, that sounds like
a... Because if you also look like what did a lot of teams do in the past? They tried to go around us, all right, and they couldn't. Now, what Farrell did is they put those three defenders under massive press. You could see that
next to the breakdown.
Yeah, next to the breakdown. So the other pick and go, or they attack those three guys, those normally first, second, and third defenders, so hard that it becomes one-on-ones the whole time. And this rush has got no effect then later on. So what happens, they come around the corner, the one try they scored, they overload it. The second try, they get into this guy's face, they make this guy doubt, and it's a one-on-one. So they get momentum. So normally you don't get momentum against the Springboks. So they worked on... The weakness of this so-called rush defense is on that three. So we put them in a hell of a pressure. They scored two tries in that area. And that's what they just continually did.
Yes, Gio, and they made our hooker and our tight head prop make reads.
Mm. Yes.
So they attack Malcolm, make the tackle, and then Francis should have picked up the read. Mm. That for me was brilliant and about the attack.
And it was the same the previous week as well. With Gerard, that had to make the decision, same. You know. Yeah. It's almost like a ghost runner. The one inside ball, but the other one is hiding themselves and he's take that space. It was quite interesting. That's why Mari scored.
Mari. And talking about Mari,
yes.
I told you
he made a difference. Difference in terms of that, different is different.
Because for me, Gio, right, is back in the day when I played for the Bulls, right, they wanted me to play like 4E. Or they wanted a lot of scrum offs back in the day to play. You cannot be 4E.
Exactly.
You understand?
Yeah.
And you can be like him, but you'll never be
him. And the same for me with Casey. They pick him because he is similar to Jameson Gibson Park, but he's not Jameson Gibson Park.
Yes, absolutely.
You guys are with me. Mm. But Connor Murray's got a set of strengths.
Basics.
And exactly. I thought he had calmness. His exit kicks were excellent.
Yeah.
He relieved
that. What did they always say? They pick you for your X factor, they drop you for your basics. Pick you for X factor, drop you for your basics.
and Connor Murray for me was actually really good for a guy who hasn't started a lot of test matches in the last 3 years for Ireland.
I
thought a lot of credit should go to him for the way he directed that team around the pitch because for me, Crowley wasn't at his best on the day, but he took a lot of control of the Irish team.
And we also know that Connor Murray is experienced, eh? But that shows you how good the coaching is. That the guy, Jamie Osborne, his second test, he's normally a center, comes in at fullback, understands everything that's going on.
Mm.
So the detail of coaching and the environment that's created for Calvin Nash, six tests, plays like he's been there forever. What's the guy's name? Blade, came on, I think second. It's just the environment of how the coaching is, how they understand it, or how it's coached, or how it's... I don't know, on a basis, I'll take a bit older there. But just, it's incredible how these guys has got no experience, but they understand exactly, even if you, Connor Murray hadn't played for a while, but they understand exactly what they must do.
Yeah, and I mean, Jamie Osborne, incredible, 22 years old, obviously he's replacing a massive hole that Hugo Keenan has obviously left when he went to the sevens as well. But yeah, those juniors coming in, and that's when it comes to, you know, building the future. We got to look at our future as well when it comes to the 2027 Rugby World Cup. Yeah. You said we got 3 years to build our attack, defense, but also what we do have. What's your feeling, your view of where South Africa and the Springboks are at the moment in building? Youngsters coming through, where the experienced guys are. Is the squad settled when it comes to having 50 guys that can do a job week in and week out against a good team?
I think... Personally, we with this squad, we're moving towards the end of its cycle. So if you think of all these guys, they can maybe push to get another World Cup in place, but I'm not sure what we're going to have left after that. So that's a bit danger. It might not be a danger for the immediate coaching staff, but it might be a danger for South African rugby.
Because most of the boys are like in the 30s, over 30s,
On the 20 side, or the fact that it's coming through, as fans, we think, oh, maybe they should win the competition. But we don't also know what the mandate is. Maybe the mandate is to produce Springboks through there. So hopefully that is the case. I'm just a little bit worried. I'm an old Super Rugby fan. I'm a hard and tried Super Rugby fan. And if you look at the Springboks and the guys that is still there, they were, hulle tanne was gesleep
in Super Rugby.
Like Kitsi, Frana, Mjalka Mas played in how many finals?
Three.
Kwagga, Pieter Steef de Tooy. So all of them, the only forwards I see that's coming in now that has really come through URC, and I don't disregard URC or whatever you can call that.
No.
But it's Ivan Roos. But he's not even ahead of Jasper Visser. Cameron Anakonkom is new, but is he going to go past Kwagga soon? So yes, we got that standout competition that we played in three finals. Wow, or whatever. But the Super Rugby guys, yes, they've got experience. But no one is coming close. And I mean, Kwagga plays his local rugby in Japan. But he played three Super Rugby finals. Yes. He was part of three. Jesse them comes from the old school, from the Victor. He played with them.
A lot
of these guys, the knowledge was passed over to them in an intense environment. Why I'm saying Super Rugby, back in the day, South Africa had its best players, Australia and New Zealand. And all of that pool of players all wanted to play for their national teams. So no one left. So all your best players was there. So you play test rugby week in, week out.
Yeah.
I don't say that is the case in Europe, but South African franchise doesn't even have our best players playing for your franchise. Yes, we took some hidings in Super Rugby, but now suddenly, now in URC, I'm a bit concerned that the Bulls has got players, but if you think the Bulls in the box squad is Johan Grobler, Jan Hendrik Wessels, even not a starter, and that's it. The Stormers, it's Ivan Roos, is not. So our local teams, the Springboks, are not playing together that much going into the next generation. It's fine now because Kutsi, Frana, all those guys, they know exactly what to do. They've been all over the world. So I'm just a bit concerned as the type of forwards URC is going to produce versus what Super Rugby produced. That's just my
big concern. And growing, especially looking at the 2027 Rugby World Cup, if you look at the squad at the moment, most of the boys are 30, 31, 32, 33. It's only like one or two guys that's younger, that's still in the 20s. But if you look at those guys, I mean, it's Ox, that's 29. It's Kurtley, that's also 28, 29 as well. It's only one or two that's high in the 20s. So when it comes to the 2027 Rugby World Cup, all of them will be 31 or 30 something. So where does it leave us when we move over to 2031?
And I think to latch on to what you just said, when is the right time to blood new players, Gio? When is it? Obviously, we're going to have an opportunity. We'll speak about Portugal. That game, Portugal, coming up. But when is the right time to give players?
And also how? Is it changing it up, especially when you look at this weekend? Do you just throw in all of those boys? Because usually when you look at a couple of years ago, how did you blood the youngsters? It's five guys getting the opportunity. First, your Pat Lambie in a couple of years, guys here, but still playing with your Bryans and your Victors and your Buckies. I think bleeding them like 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 is a much better growth than saying, yes, the whole 23, 24, 25 years old, let's have a go.
So for me, just to go back to Super Rugby, what I meant is like when all of us play against each other, not Super Rugby in his form now, but when South Africa was part of it.
Yeah.
But to latch onto that, it's also important, I always tell people, tell youngsters, you need to go to a union where you're going to train against Springboks or quality players every day. So when I say that our Bulls and the Stormers, we're not playing with the Springboks in our teams, means, yes, you might not play 10, 12 tests a year, but the four you play, the other 12, 15 games you play locally, you play with your Springbok guys. So you get that experience, Sasha playing with Damien the whole time, with Mani, with Jesse maybe, with Ceslin, I won't say Kurtley, but there's at least four of them. So now they build a little bit of a combination. That's why the Crusaders has been so good over the years. So now you build a little bit of combination. Now suddenly it's easier to put Sasha at 12 against the All Blacks with Damien, big Damien, small Damien, with Damien, big Damien, old Damien, with Mani, say with Grant. Then it's easier because they've been playing together the whole season. So now it's easier to get them onto the field. But now suddenly Sasha must play with Lucania, who's here, Jesse who's there, Pollard who's there, Faf who's there. So now it becomes difficult because they don't play every day or regularly with each other and building that combination.
Mm. And that's where Leinster, they get that upper hand because they used to play together for Leinster and they get opportunity for Ireland. So it makes it an easy transition.
Isn't Leinster Ireland, Ireland Leinster?
That's right. Yeah, okay. Copy and paste, you know.
And boys, before we move on to the other games into the SA under 20, I just quickly want to talk about the standout players for us in this whole series between Ireland and South Africa.
There's a lot when it comes to...
Sasha, for you, Gio, did he tick? He's...
If we judge him on that game, yes, I thought the first half he was a bit quiet, but everyone is nervous in your first test you play against the world number two. Mm. But then he just showed what he can do. Mm. So I think there is a positive mark. I'm still a big fan of Damian Willemse at 15. Okay. So, but
are they the same pretty much in a way?
He's a bit tougher, et cetera. But I think Shasha's got a great future. You can play him at 10, you can play him at 12, you can play him at 15. So that's good. I think he was good. I think Shia just showed his worth again. Ooh. Unbelievable.
Yeah. Captain, my captain.
He's not fat in transparent.
Exactly.
Captain, my captain.
That's a racing coach.
I think Peter Steve the Toy was himself. I think Quagga was a little bit quiet in terms of the role. I think
is it because the number 8 on his back or because he's used to number 20?
I think also because we compare him to Dwayne. Dwayne would play to the ball. Dwayne was tough and he could carry a bit. Quagga is playing to the ball. And I think, and I don't want to limit Quagga, but I think off the bench he's a bit more effective. But again, saying that it's game two. I can't be too critical. It's game two. There's still a lot of games to come. So it's difficult to make an assessment now. But from what we had from the two games, I think they were good. I think Jesse was exceptional.
Yeah. Jesse was incredible.
And his work rate and stuff. Damon was also good.
Strong.
I think Paulie was reliable again. Yeah. Grant Williams impressed me when he came on. Mm. He was
brilliant.
You were scrum off. You can.
No,
you
no,
can
Granty, for me, I don't. I'm gonna go back to the final that they play, the European Cup.
Yes.
Where Grant, for me, was man of the match, and I think people want to talk about his speed. Yes, he's extremely fast, but I want people to look at his quality of his passing.
Absolutely.
Yes. I want people to look at his speed to the breakdown and his option taking once he's got the ball in his hand. I think that for me stands out from Grant Williams, and I think he's got a bright future.
Absolutely.
And hopefully soon that he'll have the number 9 of the Springboks.
For sure.
Yeah, because a lot of the backs did well, especially all of them. If you could look at the power ranges as well. The power ranges was incredible.
Yes.
Absolutely. The power ranges. But I mean, the forwards as well. We spoke about it in the mall not functioning here and there, but I mean, with the scrums, Frana still showing his word. Oxy, not even with the scrum, with the tackling and stuff as well. He's physical. The Eben Etzebeth giving 120% every time he plays.
And showing a bit of variation in his game. He can be physical and have some nice passes. See, So that was good.
Ireland, anyone of Ireland that we thought were absolutely exceptional in the past two games?
I was Osborne surprised me a little bit. Yes. I mean, I kind of thought like there's going to be weakness over there when it comes to kicking, catching those ice balls. But if you look at this past weekend, he was like fussy here. Osborne air.
Yep.
Okay, you didn't miss any contestable kick. I don't know if it's the kick was too far or whatever the case
it
is, but he caught all of them. And so he was incredible for me. Mm. And then obviously a couple of loose forwards was Van der Vleer and Doris, and the boys showed some class.
Doris was excellent, I thought.
Yes, Doris, unbelievable. But also a guy we don't give enough recognition to is Joe McCarthy, that massive number 4. So Joe McCarthy was incredible for me. I think Keller is normally playing behind Sheehan. Dan Sheehan. And I think Keller just showed like he can also come to the party. And I think someone had the other argument now, maybe Keller can start and Sheehan can come off the bench because I think they believe he's better when he starts and Sheehan can have an impact.
Yeah, Sheehan is faster.
Yes,
that's more
competition. I think the props with the props, I think they probably have to look in there.
But Porter struggling. He struggled a bit.
Yeah.
Porter against Frana as well.
Porter struggled in the URC. Porter struggled in the champion. And honestly, from a scrummaging point of view, and that's my
scrummaging.
Scrummaging. Vulkulo had his number in that semi-final.
Absolutely.
And is it Cyril Bai?
Toulouse.
From France.
Toulouse had his number in the final. So he definitely didn't have the best of series.
So I'm not sure how they're going to go forward, but I think there's some good, exciting backs coming through and loose forwards. I'm just worried for them about their forwards, their front row, like Tad Folon is how many, Kian Healy is, I don't know if they're going to make another World Cup. And your main guy with the corn ropes, Billy.
Yes.
They're struggling. Mm. So I'm not sure if going forward, like where they're going to find those props.
Mm.
What a brilliant series. Hey, we got the Ruckers. We have a rivalry. Mm. I think it's cemented now, Gio. We have a rivalry with Ireland.
Green rivalry.
The green rivalry with Ireland. I don't know when we're going to see them again, but it's going to be too long.
See them next year. We'll see them next year, hopefully.
Exactly.
Let's move over to the game for this weekend. Okay, yes. Bloemfontein. We've seen the squad. There's a couple of new changes. There's a couple of debuts. We've got Mani coming, getting his opportunity. And then we got the main man, Salman Murad, getting his captaincy. Huh?
Yeah, that's brilliant. Captain, congrats, Mooney.
Huh? Captain 66 for the Springboks. Your thoughts on Rassie making a lot of changes? And we spoke about, you know, youngsters bleeding them with the senior players. And this is all pretty much not a lot of senior players with 150 caps.
I think the first thing we need to take out of this weekend is forget it's Portugal. Because a lot of people are going to say, yeah, they played against Portugal. That's why they did, hopefully, get 50 or whatever. But let's look at the effort. Let's look at how Armani controls the game. Let's look at how Krappi comes on Mornay Verbeek. And let's look at what they do in the system.
Yes,
there's bigger tests to come. But I think we should judge them on the work rate and what they do apart. And not at the result and say, yeah, it's Portugal, that's why it's going easy. Mm. So I think that will be the main takeout for me is, because it's easy to say, Portugal, I'm not going to watch because we're probably going to beat them by what all due respect. But I think it's time that we look at who can fit in where, who actually understands this game plan, if we want to play wide. Does it even Ruas actually bring something different to a Jasper Visser and to a Quagga when it comes to this type of game plan we want to play? And then let's assess them and assess them on that rather than to say, it's a linebacker, it was Makler.
But partner, looking at this backline, Kubus, Rein, Nahmani, Lebok, Mapimpi, Ander Estres, and Kurtley Aronson, passing. That's a dangerous backline that we have.
So we should give them a fair chance and not say it was Portugal. Those are quality players. They've played big tests. Mm. Some of them played against the All Blacks. So let's assess them and see what does Andre Estrezen bring different to Damien? Or what does he bring the same as Damien? The same with Mani, the same with Lokanya. Lokanya was the talk of the town just before the World Cup, before he got injured.
Yeah.
So there's still a quality
amazing player. Yeah,
exactly.
Mm. And a couple of faces, would you like to see some other guys getting opportunities? Is there anyone in the URC that stood out for you, but it was brilliant? I mean, looking at it, we obviously had Sasha that was coming off the bench from a 10 and a 15 point of view. He's on the bench this weekend as well. Should guys like Sia Masuku and the boys get opportunities? Is there anyone else in the URC that stood out for you?
It's probably a good problem to have, because you got Mani, who just played in the World Cup, who also needs game time, and then Sia Masuku played well. A guy I'm really excited about is Erwan Fenton. I don't know if he's a beast.
He's going to bring something.
He's going to bring something. It's sad what happened to Edwell. We would have seen him. Yeah. We would have liked to see him on another test. To see Andre Estreisen together with Lokanya Amp, that partnership, because they're going to play together at the Sharks. So that partnership can be important going forward.
Obvious,
The wings, Kurtley, give the man a rest, man. But obviously he needs to play.
Mark's a season klaar. Yes.
Okay. And then to see Fassi to bring something different, because we're going to have Damien who's probably going to fold into 10, 12, 15 is going to be a utility. Sasha, we don't know where. But let's see Fassi, he had an incredible season at the Sharks, which is also good. Again, that combination of the two centers with the fullback, with the winger. So that, see, when they play together in South Africa, it's easier to play them together in a Portugal test, because they know how the level might increase or the level might be tighter, but at least they've got an understanding of how they play together. Up front, the props, it's nice. I also happy for Grobby.
Yeah, Grobby. Yes.
Being a hooker playing at the...
I think he's one for the future. I think people must take into account that he will become a good player, rugby player in future, but it might not be now. So I think we need a bit of patience with him. He used to play prop, he struggled, then he went to hooker, now he's back to prop. So I think that project, give it a little bit of time.
Let's see,
But he's gonna be someone to reckon with. And Salman, brilliant for him. Because he's been struggling. He had a tough couple of last two or three years with injuries and stuff. So I think very, very, very happy for him to be the captain and to lead the team. So I think very, very exciting going into this going into this game?
Super exciting, yeah. And I mean, when it comes to Stormer season, he was injured the first couple of months. Yeah. But he was injured, but he was carrying water around. I mean, the leadership that he has is incredible. And Pepis,
the Murats. Okay,
be proud. Murats. Oh,
congrats, okay, guys.
Guys, number 66, proud moment.
Partner, that's Pero. Excellent. You know what I like about Mooney is the way he conducts himself. His presence. It's a proper Wolfsian. I mean, he's obviously new. Like, you've captained Paul Boyce, captained the Craven. We captains the Stormers as a young man, so the captaincy part we will step into it, obviously being a big moment for him as an individual, but I think captaincy comes natural to him.
Yes, 100%. And you know, we'll know how to handle it. Obviously he's been captain a long time, but also knowing even though it's a big stage, I mean, he's got it under the belt. Yeah.
And maybe if we chuck in a Brock Harris, you know, we always chuck in a Scott Brits or someone. I'm just joking. But I mean, it would be great to see another 40-year-old make a debut and win a World Cup.
And Boykies, before we wrap it up, let's quickly take a plane. Let's get on to Qantas and we go all the way down under to raise this boys.
Rugby championship and coming up as well.
Yes. Mm. You're impressed with them?
Against England?
Difficult to say because we expected Razor to be this bombshell guy that's going to take the All Blacks to coast-to-coast rugby. But I think what they're finding is a bit of identity. I think they're learning from the Northern Hemisphere that you need to stay into games for the last 10 to 15 minutes. Yes, they've beaten the England, who's a very, very good team. And it's going to become a very good team. They've beaten them by 1 point and then by 7 points with the last small thing. Ooh. But that will build character. Those tests they lost under Fozzie, they lost against Argentina. They lost those kind of type of test. So maybe, and also for Reza, he's been in the job, he's got the guys for 10 days, they had a bit of nerves, it is settled now. But also, they've also played with some campaigners, but I think let's give them also time and see where they're going to get. But I think he's got a good mantra, and he always talk about Koro and stuff with mana. So they'll produce something. One thing, I think their lock stocks is a bit, that's why their lineout struggled. I mean, it's a massive loss to lose Brody Rotelek and Sam Whitelock. Massive. In that department. Scrums, I think they showed they can scrum. Yes, but England doesn't have a good scrum. Loose forward, they were good, but I think locks and nines, that will be the challenge. In 10, maybe 10.
Nines as well. Aaron Smith.
Partner, I told you, nines is a big loss. And Roygaard, I know.
Roygaard,
Kemi Roygaard was brilliant in Super Rugby, but that was a big loss for them at nine. And the other, I also want to give Finlay Christie. Once you've been on the bench the whole time and then all of a sudden you start we must also give him a bit of time to grow in that in that position, because he's a brilliant scrum half. It's tough, honey, winking.
It's tough, especially in that,
But what they did well is they've got Scott Robinson has been a head coach. They've got, I think Jason Holland has been a head coach at some states. Scott, what's the other... I can't remember the I see his face now. He's been a head coach. And Leon McDonald's been a head coach. Mm. So that calmness they will bring. They will understand, listen, don't panic too much. We've got a plan. Mm. A head coach understands what he needs from an assistant. So when he's an assistant, he will know what to do. So I think each of them are going to take their own little area as a head coach. Like, what does a head coach expect from me? And be an assistant. So that's a good thing about having a lot of head coaches around you. Also understanding the bigger picture, because they'll understand, listen here, maybe my attack is not this week that important, so that gives the defense guy. But they will have an understanding from a overview, and also from what would I have expected from my assistant coach now. They'll have that.
And quickly picking Bowden at 10, Bowden at 15, do you leave Damien McKenzie at 10 going into the Rugby Championship? What do you do with that little conundrum for
like
there?
McKenzie, actually.
Do you like McKenzie at 10?
At the end of the day, it's going to be, it's a more attacking pick. When it comes to the physicality, when you play South African, it's a grand type of game, then it's a different story. But if you move the ball around, he finds holes for you.
So let's look at it like this. If Bowden Barrett goes down, who's going to be 10? We know Bowden can play 10. So let's play, they should play McKenzie 10, get him used to it, let him play, And minutes under the belt. So when they get to World Cup, Tsitsi Mwanga comes back or whatever, they all have three. But if you put McKenzie at the back now, and they still have Steven Perofetu, who can play 10. So I think give those guys the 10 and Bowden can always come on when it's time. But they need to build their stocks now, because if Bowden goes down, you have to play McKenzie.
Okay.
Yeah.
My opinion.
Can't wait, can't wait. Rugby championship around the corner. Okay, we're going Aussies that side, but then you got them coming this side. Okay, Ellis Park. Woo. Yeah, Ellis Park.
And in Cape Town, Cape Crusaders.
Shell Stadium, huh? That's going to be a cracker.
Kaapse mensen gaan mal gaan. Huh? Kaapse mensen gaan mal gaan as jy oomblik die ander kom. Okay?
Tattoos in one.
Yes, that's good.
Yo, Gio. I mean, we've covered a lot of things, man. Gio, thank you very much for the time. Yo, when we talk rugby with this guy, hey?
We say a two-hour podcast. Oh, really? We say two, three more hours to talk.
Okay, Ruckers, 2 hours, you sit down.
Yes, see.
Yo, thank you very much for the time. I know it's always awesome to come out here. I mean, you're a friend of the show. We're changing it to BTR consultant now.
That's okay, soon. That's a new title. Okay.
BTR consultant. I'll just talk to HR.
Money will come in 2031. But yeah, thank you very much for making the time, hey. And it's always an honor for us to have you on the show. I mean, the Ruckers will appreciate it as well. Yeah. When we cut it deep, I mean, technical stuff. It's stuff that we want to educate, inform our Ruckers, and it's incredible just for you to share some time with us here.
Yeah, excellent, Pokey. Thank you for coming back.
Always having me, Ruckers. I'm part of the family. I can't wait to be back.
Okay, let's go back to back. Okay, guys, that's your Aplon. Let's go.
Oh, partner, I just love listening to Gio Aplon. Mm. Honestly, I know he was one of my favorite players at the times, but his rugby IQ is next level. Mm.
Next level, hey, the darling of Austin, hey. So, I've actually got a headache of all this rugby, but I mean, it's important stuff. It's stuff that we've seen throughout this past couple of weeks, a couple of concerns we actually have going forward for SA Rugby and those type of things. But, I mean, the knowledge that the man has is unbelievable. Is he coaching or what?
I don't know. He shouldn't keep that thing in the office, okay? Gio, when you're watching the episode, you can't keep all of that knowledge in the office, okay? I mean, it's appreciate you. Also appreciate you be behind the Rocky boy. Okay.
A friend of the show.
I love it. Partner, but let's go straight into this weekend's fixtures. Mm-hmm. Let's go to our Super Sport Bet Picks.
Bet Picks, hey.
Super Sport Bet Picks, boy. Yes, let's go first. To the Bokke. Springboks versus Portugal. 5 o'clock at Bloemfontein.
5 o'clock in Bloemfontein. Obviously, we're expecting a lekker atmosphere at 5 o'clock in Bloemfontein. But a couple of debuts. Obviously, I think we're going to be a little bit too strong for them. They've been awesome in the Rugby World Cup, if you look at it, Portugal.
Okay.
Portugal has been good. So hopefully the combinations that we have at the moment, okay, it's a couple of new faces, a couple of new guys coming in. Those combinations can work. But I will say, obviously, the Springboks plus 20. Okay. 20.
Yes, I'm going to go Springboks plus 30.
Don't be on the scoff. You're on the scoff now.
Okay. I think we're going to have a backlash. I really think in Bloemfontein, I know we were good, but our Springbok team should still beat a Portugal team by 30 points.
Agree. Okay. Yeah, so,
then up next, early morning, we're going to have New Zealand versus Fiji. Saturday morning.
Island boys.
Yes, who you got?
Hey, obviously New Zealand is going to blast them off the park. They're obviously not going to go full strength as well, giving guys opportunity. I mean, this whole week is going to be, you know, especially the strong countries giving guys opportunity. So I'm going to go the Blacks plus 20 it is. I'm a 20 boy.
On the repeat, Ruckers, okay? I'm going to go All Blacks plus 12.
Yes.
The Fijians are never easy. They will be up for it emotionally against the All Blacks, knowing that the All Blacks might not play their best side. So I'm going to go All Blacks plus 12.
I agree. Okay. I think Fiji's going to come out hungry.
Exactly.
Looking at the Fijian Drewers, there's something there.
Okay. All right. Then we got Australia versus Georgia. Tricky one. Australia versus Georgia. Very tricky one.
Very tricky one, yeah. I mean, Australia has shown a lot now against Wales. So I'm going to back the Aussies, the Wallabies.
Yes.
Plus eight.
Yeah, I'm going to go Wallabies only by 5.
By 5.
The Georgians beat Japan in Japan. The Georgians is a very good outfit. I'm going to go only plus 5. I'm not convinced yet by the Wallabies because the box gave them 40 at Twickenham not too long ago. So I'm for Wales, but so that's why I'm not too convinced about the Wallabies yet. Only plus five points against Georgia.
Okay.
All right. The next game, we got Chile against Scotland. Chile against Scotland.
Scotland. I'm going to go Scotland plus 8. I think Scotland is a strong outfit, and I know Duane and the boys will obviously play and get those opportunities. A lot of these European teams, they're at the end of the season, so it's probably the last game. So I don't want to say it's a dead rubber, but hopefully they'll send out the big teams, and I'm going to say Scotland plus 8.
I'm going to go Scotland plus 15.
15?
15, mm. 2 scores, mm. 2 tries, so that's going to be my pick. Yeah, very interesting game. Obviously, Chile last year, their first World Cup. Yeah. They were very competitive,
but I still
think Scotland plus 15.
Yeah.
Then,
there's
a last one, Sunday. It's Uncle Eddie against the Italian Stallions, okay?
Uncle Eddie?
Yes, Japan versus Italy.
Japan versus Italy?
Yes.
Oh, that's a tough one, eh? I think it's a tough one. I'm going to back the Italians. The Italians has been incredible in the Six Nations. They are on their way up now at the moment and looking at what Benetton is doing as well. So I'm going to go the Italians plus 10.
Italians and plus 10.
You like Eddie?
I'm going to go Eddie's boys plus 5. Eddie's boys plus 5. Mm. Japan to beat Italy. We need an upset this weekend. We need an upset, Ruckers. So Japan plus 5.
Plus 5?
Yeah. Come on, boykie.
It's spaghetti time, boy.
Follow Eddie. Even as he kiss our klage sakke. Guys, and that is our SuperSportBET picks for the weekend.
Okay.
Buddy, another, obviously, a more rugby-dominant, analytic type of episode, which I think is good.
It's needed. It's needed, especially for us, for BTR. It's important, especially dissecting what happened in the incoming series. World number 1 against world number 2, okay? Mm. And
Still that same way.
It's still the same way. Okay. Obviously, the last game didn't go our way, but at the end of the day, incredible incoming series. I mean, South African rugby can be proud of what the boys did the last couple of weeks and showing a couple of new things. So hopefully, when it comes to rugby championship, we'll see a different thing.
And Ruckers, Dominic had whole speech. Because the Bok lost, we're not gonna badmouth anyone this week. And players were gefired. Nothing. We put on our seatbelt. We support our boys. We stay loyal. We stay true. We lost the test match.
It is what it is.
And then after that, you make sure if you watch this episode and you finish, then we press share. We send it on the WhatsApp.
Yes, yes.
Then you can forward it to 5 people, and that 5 people forward it on to another 5 people, and now we sound like a pyramid scheme, but what I want you to do over the weekend, okay, Ruckers?
100%, yeah. We gotta share it like a gossip story.
Exactly.
Yeah, everywhere. It doesn't have to be YouTube or Facebook. Okay. Yeah. WhatsApp.
100%.
Still don't be WhatsApp, be group chat.
Exactly. Yeah. Buddy, and then a chicken rappy.
It's a chicken rappy, yeah. All good things come to an end. Incredible episode. Speaking to the mayor of Austin, is it? Yes.
Okay.
He's becoming the friend of the show. But yeah, fantastic. I mean, rugby obviously is coming to a little bit of an end now, a little bit of a break, especially when it comes to Europe. I mean, our boys are playing Portugal, and then we straight into rugby championship. Okay, we got to test ourselves there. Okay,
100%.
So like rugby coming up.
Yes. Mm. And Ruckers Behind the Ruck is powered and supported by SuperSportBET, okay? And now official apparel sponsors.
Old school.
Old school, okay?
You know what it is? Say back to school, because it's old school. Because we are so cool.
Okay.
Don't be a fool. I'll throw you in the pool, okay?
Kanye West, all right.
Yes. Here we go.
And partner, and a special thank you and mention to Bayers,
yes.
For hosting us.
For hosting us, yes. Okay, and be careful on Bayers, okay? This is too much, okay? If the show is too long, we might jump in here.
Knock, thank you, okay. Ruckers. That's it, buddy.
That's it, what it is, hey.
Let's go.
Guys, I'm Juan Dion.
I'm Rudy Page.
And the Ruck is clear. Let's go.
Bye-bye.